Well, good evening, and welcome all to worship tonight, everyone who is gathered here in the sanctuary, and to people who are joining us online. It's a pleasure for us to be together as we walk through this season of Lent. If you are new to this Lenten worship service, we are singing the Holden Evening Prayer Service, and as we go through tonight, I'll be singing the leader part, and Deacon Christie will be singing along with the congregation. So for the most part, when Deacon Christie is singing, just be singing along with her. The only announcement I have tonight is the announcing our March Globe offering. If you are newer to our gathering, each month we support financially a partnership ministry. And last month in February it was Teddy Bear Den. This month it is ELCA Global Hunger. And world hunger is something that's very important to Lutherans. So we are part of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America. And we have a large program that works with world hunger. So the offering that we'll use tonight will go throughout the world, but also through domestic hunger projects. And so we are going to watch a video in just a few minutes that is a part of the World Hunger Project that supports grants locally. Some of you may know that we're quite involved in feeding ministries in the congregation. We do have a community garden that will be planted quite soon. We house the community emergency food pantry in our building, and we've been doing monthly food distributions, beginning with COVID, and they'll be continuing to address the need for hunger. So it's a part of who we are. And so during the hymn tonight, you'll be invited to, if you would like to place an offering in the Globe offering, but it will go to this organization. We'll watch the video.
Sharing food with neighbors is a long-standing Lutheran tradition. From potlucks to pantries, feeding ministries are as abundant as the grace God provides. But it doesn't stop there. ELCA World Hunger knows working toward a just world where all are fed is an ambitious goal that requires projects that provide immediate relief, but also these steps toward ending hunger for good. At Lutheran Church of Hope in Anchorage, Alaska, this little garden is making a big difference. Congregation member and master gardener Don says, "I was at a composting workshop, and the Holy Spirit spoke to me saying, this is what you need to do. You need to start a garden. The community garden provides fresh, nutritious food for the congregational food pantry. In 2017, the garden yielded about 2,700 pounds of food, from peppers to potatoes to broccoli. Here's another example. At St. John's Lutheran Church in Northeast Philadelphia, 250 families visit Feast of Justice each week for lunch, food boxes, and a special food box program just for seniors. Volunteers power this pantry ministry, putting in 325 hours of service time each week. This year, both Don and Pastor Tricia participated in the ELCA World Hunger Network training in Washington, D.C., where they share their local service with their elected officials. Pastor Tricia and the Pennsylvania delegation share stories about the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, while Don's conversation with his senator focused on environmental protection and agricultural research. Pastor Tricia says, "Feast of Justice is blessed to be connected to a local congregation and to ELCA World Hunger because of the resources it brings. From domestic hunger grants to online resources and national trainings, we strengthen the work of our mission because of ELCA World Hunger, breaking the grip of poverty for good."
Jesus Christ, you are the light of the world.
The light no darkness can overcome.
Stay with us now, for it is evening.
And the day is almost over.
Let your light scatter the darkness.
And shine within your people here.
Blessed are you, Creator of the universe. From old you have led your people by night and day. May the light of your Christ make our darkness bright. For your word and your presence are the light of our pathways. And you are the life and life of all creation. My prayer rise up like incense before you, the lifting up of my hands as an offering to you. O God, I call to you.
Come
to me now. O God, hear my voice when I cry. Let my prayer rise up like incense before you, the lifting up of my hands as an offering to you. Keep watch within me, God. Deep in my heart, may the light of your love be burning bright. Let my prayer rise up like incense before you, the lifting up of my hands as an offering to you. All praise to the God of all creation. stand up, Spirit of love. Let my prayer rise up, like incense before you, the lifting up of my hands as an offering to you.
May our prayers come before you, O God, as incense, and may your presence surround and fill us so that in union with all creation, we might sing your praise and in your love in our lives.
At the table of the Lord, I will feast at the table of the Lord. I won't hunger anymore at his table. Come all you weary, come and his yoke is easy, his burden light. He is able, he will restore at the table of the Lord. There is peace at the table of the Lord. There is peace at the table of the Lord. I won't worry anymore at his table. Ooh. There is healing at the table of the Lord. There is healing at the table of the Lord. Oh, I won't suffer at his table. Ooh. Come all you weary, come and find. His yoke is easy, his burden light. He is able, he will restore at the table of the Lord. I know he has a place for me. Oh, what joy will fill my heart with the saints around the mercy seat of God. Come on, come and find, his yoke is easy.
scripture reading for tonight is from the Gospel of Matthew, the 6th chapter. It's the second half of the Lord's Prayer in Matthew, and the verses immediately following, beginning with verse 12. "And forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And do not bring us to the time of trial, but rescue us from the evil one. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses." Well, you are fortunate tonight as we continue our series about gathering at the table. It's the table of forgiveness tonight. And you are going to learn a few skills, partially from real physical skills, as well as the spiritual skills that come from listening. But I'm going to preach a version of the very first sermon that I really remember hearing as a child. So, if you are 8 or 9, which I was when I first heard a version of this sermon, you might just be in luck that you may actually remember this. And this was an explanation of how forgiveness works. And it came from a pastor from my childhood, Pastor Watney, who is actually buried just a few miles south of here at West Prairie Lutheran Church. He was a terribly, terribly elderly man when he had retired from West Prairie and he came to my church of Del Rapids. You know, he was probably 66, 67 years old. And he seemed so old. But we knew that he was perhaps one of the brightest men we had ever met, because the breadth of Pastor Watney's knowledge was wide, wide indeed. Because he was born in the 1920s in Norway, and in the 1940s, as a young man, he immigrated to the United States. And he ended up learning more languages than you can shake a stick at. And this is going to bear into the sermon here. They moved to the United States, learned English, language number 2. At some point, he felt called to go into ministry. And so, as he went through his seminary studies, he learned to read Greek and he learned to read Hebrew. And then he felt called to become a missionary overseas, and even evangelist in the 1950s. To the country of Cameroon in Western Africa. And even to this day, the Lutheran churches in South Dakota have partnerships with the Lutheran churches in that country in Cameroon. The national language was French, so we learned French. And the two native languages that were spoken, the indigenous languages, were Fulani and Baya. So this seemingly little old man who stood in front of us knew more about the Bible than I probably ever will. He could read the Bible in 7 languages, and he could converse in 5. And he gave this very, very simple sermon that I've never forgotten. Because you may not know this, but be ready to be impressed. I have set the table with a monkey trap. Do you see it? Seriously, this is a monkey trap. Because in Cameroon, back in the day, they did, it's a true story, a problem with monkeys. We think of monkeys as just a nice little zoo animal, but the small monkeys that would live in the villages were mean, aggressive, greedy, and they would make a mess. So what would happen if you left your windows open, a monkey would get into your house, they would steal your things, and they would wreck your house. So, this is how to make a monkey trap. I told you there would be skills with this. So what you do, you just get a piece of twine. This is a piece of baling twine, which all the farmers know. You can fix anything on earth with this. Duct tape and baling twine, and you could fix the space shuttle. Start with a bowling knot. You find a tree. Preferably where the monkeys could see you, but not too close. Teach you how to do a bowline. You make a whole rabbit comes out of the hole, goes around the tree, goes back through the hole. That's going to be important for the sermon. So you tie that to the tree. And I think this will be about long enough. And then all you need is a jar. A jar that is almost the exact size as the monkey's hand. And I get to be the monkey tonight. So I have a half-gallon jar that my hand fits into. So, on this side, you make a square knot. Under, over. That's going to make a difference to the sermon, too. Square knot. All the Boy Scouts in the room, I told you this would come in handy someday. So, there you go. You've got a jar, a rope, and then you just need some bait. This is some corn. My brother-in-law grew. It's an old-fashioned variety. It's wonderful. But all you do to make monkey trap. Ta-da! Are you impressed yet? I'm waiting for the monkey. So then all you did is you'd sit back and you'd wait. And this is the reason it was good if you had the monkey see you, because they'd be curious. Like a greedy, mean version of Curious George. And then what the monkey does. This worked this afternoon. If it doesn't work now, we might need a hammer. Because what happens is the monkey gets in here. It's being sneaky. It grabs the corn and it runs back to the tree. You have just caught a monkey. Because the moment I make a fist, you cannot get out of this jar. And so I remember what the pastor said. At this point, all you needed to do was go up and throw a blanket over the monkey and carry it away with the rope, and you had caught your monkey. All the monkey needed to do was let go. They could get away. For the darker version of this, you also could just leave this, and that monkey will die eventually of starvation, of thirst, because that monkey would rather die than let go of this. This is where I hope the sermon goes correctly. Because if I let go, excuse me a second. I'm free. This is a sermon about how forgiveness works. Because first, a few things about sin and what it does to us before we get back to this jar. Because all of us have had things happen to us where people have sinned against us. Real things. And so we throw forgiveness around lightly sometimes in church. It is one of our core practices that get at who Jesus is, who God is, and how God intends to fix the world. Because forgiveness doesn't feel natural to most of us. Forgiveness is for real sins. I'm not talking about you're walking down the hall of school and you bump into someone and say, I'm sorry. You know, that's not really for forgiveness. What forgiveness does, it gets at those wounds that someone has done to me or has done to you that have changed us. Big things. And we have all experienced tremendously painful things. You may know the statistic. 1 in 4 women and girls will face some type of sexual abuse in their life, statistically. 1 in 6 boys and men will face some type sexual abuse. What do you do with that when you just have that heaviness of someone has sinned against you? Or abandonment. Someone you love deeply is just suddenly gone from your life forever by choice. And that's real, and it scars the person. Or, example I saw on Netflix the other night, there's a series out about a counterfeiter who's just a tremendous counterfeiter and worked with rare documents. And there's a story in this series where there's this dealer in rare artifacts who was swindled out of $175,000 that he's never going to get back. Everything he had, basically, is stolen. What do you do with those things when we've been sinned against? Because what feels natural to most of us is to grab onto that stuff, because hitting back is more natural for most of us. We're being resentful or angry, and the thought of forgiving is like, I'm not going to let that person off the hook. That person who just harms me so deeply. And what happens, without us even realizing it, is we have been stuck. And so, a description of what happens in our lives, we've got these big, traumatic events that have happened to us, and we're holding on to them. We try to move on with our lives, you know, and we don't even notice it. You know, that hate or that anger. And we get this far, and we are stuck. And so this is where my hand is getting bigger every time, where we come to the scripture that you read tonight. We pray every week, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Even when it is so tempting to be stuck in the dark. Haven't, and that we're not. And there's a description that follows the Lord's Prayer of this that is descriptive. For if you forgive others their trespasses, their sins, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others, your heavenly Father will not forgive. But if you do not forgive others, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. It's not as if the Lord is standing behind us with a stick and saying, well, you better just get over it. You better just forgive, and you better get on with your life, or I'm not going to forgive you. That's not what the scripture is saying at all. I think what the scripture is saying is the price of freedom is even the Lord has trouble working with this. And that we would say that Jesus is sitting right with us, inviting us to a way to be free. And so how forgiveness works, and this comes from a wonderful teacher named Lewis Sneeds. I learned this from him. He said, first we acknowledge the things that need to be forgiven. Real things, real hurts, real things that we are carrying. And then what we do is, by the grace of God, we start letting go by stopping wishing that person to go to hell. Wishing that that person who has hurt me so hard gets exactly what they deserve. Because that's the thing. They really do deserve it. And so what forgiveness becomes is the choice to start letting go. That same story of that businessman who was swindled out of $175,000. Powerful scene in there where he contacts the father of the man who is now in prison and said, please let your son know that I've forgiven him. He has wrecked my financial life, but he is not going to destroy my emotional life, my physical life, my spiritual life. And the person starts to let go. It doesn't always happen quickly. It doesn't always happen at once. But we release. No, this doesn't mean reunion. It doesn't mean we forgive and that we forget when we talk about this table of forgiveness. It's not saying, yep, it's all done and over and we'll never think about it. And instead, what we do is we forgive and we remember. And we learn. And it doesn't necessarily mean reunion with that relationship that was broken. But what happens is in the end, and what the releasing does and what forgiveness does, is that person is allowed to enter back into the human race. And so what happens to us, the person that has been sinned against, the miracle that starts happening is some of that venom goes away, and we recognize that we too are sinners, that we have hurt people, we have said and done things, maybe not as drastic as what has been done to us. I need the grace of God just as much as that person needs the grace of God. And that's the shape of forgiveness. And it allows us to do this. The person who was set free in forgiving is the person who was sinned against. And so the scripture takes on a whole new meaning. If you forgive others, I can welcome you into a new future, our Lord says. If you do not forgive, you're still trapped. And so what Jesus does, Jesus brings us back with the forgiveness for us, for the forgiveness for humanity, is giving us a new way to live, a new way to set the table, and in ways to regain what was lost in the Garden of Eden. To go back to the point where it's not about getting even, but it's the point of living in the kingdom of God. A bunch of broken people. And that's a miracle. So what forgiveness does is it dismantles. Yes, our hurts are going to be scars, but they're not going to be open, festering wounds. Remember I said this is a bowler knot? This is not like a big old granny knot that you tie together, and if you pull on it really hard, you can never untie it. This bowler is a hinge knot, so it's like it's got a hinge on the door. So no matter how hard you pull on that, you can untie it. A square knot? Another hinge knot. No matter how hard you pull on it, you can wiggle that hinge and you can untie it. And so what we end up with is this piece is being a trap, it becomes a piece of rope. And think of all that energy that we expend in being furious and angry and holding on to being trapped with people. What this does, it allows that energy to go back being a piece of twine that can bale some hay, that can feed a beautiful horse, or bale some straw that will be useful, a very useful bedding. And what this becomes, suddenly it ceases to be bait that we've used to catch us and trap us in that brokenness. And in that freedom, this, it just becomes corn again. And by the way, this corn, I had the best cornbread of my entire life this week. This is corn. And so it goes into something that can be creative. is no longer monkey trap. We have reset the table. Because that's what Jesus does with forgiveness for us and an invitation to forgive others. It's to reset our table with things that could just kill us and trap us and break us, to transform it into something that's good. Because this half-gallon jar in about 2 months is going to be filled with my wife's rhubarb juice, which is the best juice on the planet. It's no longer trap. It's something that's being used for good. So I'm going to read the scripture again. Now, what if we are? And again, I say forgiveness is a miracle. It's a miracle that sets the forgiver free and gives us the chance to live and to go and do what God intends us to do. But listen to that scripture again. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your Heavenly Father will also forgive you. You've reset the table. You have a different perspective. You have a different way to enter into life. And it's letting go of the other. But if you do not forgive others, neither will your Father forgive you. Your Father will love you. And this is a long process. When you have clearly been deeply wounded and deeply hurt, this isn't something that goes like this. It may be a miraculous unveiling, a little bit at a time, and a little more, and a little more. And so suddenly, a sermon by one of the wisest people I've ever met, multiple languages, he summarizes the core of the Christian life into a little piece of rope, an empty jar, and some corn. Doesn't matter how smart you are. Doesn't matter how rich you are. Doesn't matter how popular you are. This is a core way that God is going to heal the world and you. Amen. That is good news.
An angel went from God to a town called Nazareth to a woman whose name was Mary. The angel said to her, "Rejoice, highly favored, for God is with you. You shall bear a child, and his name shall be Jesus, the chosen one of God Most High." And Mary said, "I am the servant of my God. I live to do your will."
My soul proclaims your greatness, O God, and my spirit rejoices in you. You have looked with love on your servant here, and blessed me all my life through. Great and mighty are you, O Holy One. Strong is your kindness evermore. How you favor the weak and lowly one, humbling the proud of heart. You have cast the mighty down from their thrones and uplifted the humble of heart. You have filled the hungry with wondrous things and left the mighty are you,
O faithful one.
Strong is your justice, strong your love. As you promised to Sarah and Abraham, kindness forevermore. My soul proclaims your greatness, O God, and my spirit rejoices in you. You have looked with love at your servant here, and blessed me all my life. God of mercy, hold us in love. In peace, we pray to you.
God of mercy, hold us in love.
For peace and salvation, we pray to you. For peace between nations, for peace between peoples.
God of mercy, hold us in love.
For us who are gathered to worship and praise you.
God of mercy, hold us in love.
For all of your servants who live out your gospel.
God of mercy, hold us in love.
For all those who govern, that justice might guide them.
God of mercy, hold us in love.
For all those who labor in service to others. And weather that nourishes all of creation.
God of mercy, hold us in love.
Keep watch on our loved ones and keep us from danger.
God of mercy, hold us in love.
For all the beloved who rest in your mercy.
God of mercy, hold us in love.
Help us, comfort us all of our days.
Keep us,
hold us, praise us,
great and merciful God, source and ground of all goodness and life, give to your people the peace that passes all understanding and the will to live your gospel of mercy and justice through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
God, remember us in your love and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. And forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Let us bless our God.
Praise to you.
May God, Creator, bless us and keep us. May Christ be ever light
for our lives. May the Spirit of love be our guide and path for all of our days.
Peace, to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.